Hello children, welcome to the next session of Geography class 10. So before we begin, a quick round of what we have already studied in our Geography lesson. We started with the chapter on transportation and we have studied about the importance of transportation. Why is transportation important to any nation? Then various modes of transportation we have studied, like the roads, the railways, the airways and the waterways. Amongst the roadways was the national highways, which is made by the National Highway Authority of India, and it is responsible for the development, maintenance and management of the national highways. Next, we have also studied about the expressways, the difference between the expressways and the state highways and the national highways. We have studied about the projects undertaken by the NHAI, that is the Golden Quadrilateral, the North-South-East-West Corridor, and the various other types of roads like the state highways, district roads, rural roads, and the border roads. We have studied about the advantages of roadways and the disadvantages of roadways. Today, we are going to start with the next mode of transportation, that is the railways. And children, we will go according to the scope of the syllabus and underline only what is important. So children, please focus on the railways. Okay. Now, the railways constitute the principal mode of transportation for freight and passengers. It brings together people from the farthest corners of the country for conducting business, sightseeing, pilgrimage, education, etc. Now, we know about the importance of the railways, how it is able to bring people from all over the different regions of India together, be it for conducting business, be it for conducting sightseeing, pilgrimage, or it be it education. So, railways always play a very important role in the development of the nation. Now, railways was first introduced into India in the year 1853, when a line was constructed from Mumbai to Thane. Please underline this. Now, at present, it is the largest. We come to the third paragraph, children. At present, it is the largest and the busiest rail networks in the world, transporting over 18 million passengers and more than 2 million tons of freight daily. It is the world's largest employer and more than 1.4 million employees. So, please note that it is employing also as many as 1.4 million employees. Okay, now we know that many cities have their own suburban networks to cater to the commuters, and in this respect we have the metros running on the metropolitan cities, and the main cities where the metros run is Delhi, Calcutta, Chennai, Mumbai, and there are now many other cities and our own Lucknow is also having a metro network. Apart from metro, there are suburban trains. Now, please see, there are suburban trains which are called the Electric Multiple Unit, EMU. These usually have 9 coaches, or sometimes they may have 12 to handle the rush hour traffic. Indian railways carry huge variety of goods ranging from mineral ores, fertilizers, petrochemicals, agricultural produce, iron and steel. Please underline, these are important products. Ports and major urban areas have their own freight lines. Thus, railways help in accelerating the development of industry and agriculture. Please underline all this. Now, about the growth of the Indian railways. Now, please underline that the railway system has been divided into 17 zones. Have you found this? It has been divided into 17 zones. Now, the track system. About the track system, the track system is based on the width of the track of the Indian Railways. Now, it is divided into three categories. Let us turn the page to find this. Now, children, there are three categories amongst which the first is your broad gauge. The distance between the rails is 1.67 meters. Please underline in your textbook 1.67 meters. Now, the total length of the broad gauge lines is 54,257 kilometers. So, that is not important, though it is not asked. You just confine to 1.67 for the width of the broad gauge. Now, almost all the main routes are broad gauge. Broad gauge system links major ports of India with the interior towns, industrial centers, and handles 85% of the total goods traffic in terms of tons kilometer. It is also called the India gauge. Okay, now children, now this broad gauge, in Hindi it is called the Badi line. You must have heard being spoken about that the train is coming on the Badi line se aa rahi hai, and the meter gauge is the Choti line. So sometimes the main trains are all coming in the Badi line, and the smaller one is your meter gauge, which is your Choti line. Okay, now children, now this meter gauge is 1 meter. The distance between the rails is 1 meter, and major parts of the country, they are all, in fact all the states, northern UP, Bihar, Assam, Rajasthan, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, they are also connected with the meter gauge. Now, even lesser than the meter gauge is the narrow gauge. This is 0.762 meters and in many cases 0.610 meter also. Now, it accounts for 3.96% of the total route length, and it is confined to the hilly regions. You may underline these facts. Now, meter, the narrow gauge, you will find in the mountainous regions, all your hill stations you may find, like the Darjeeling, the Shimla, Siliguri. So, you must have seen the toy train if you visited Darjeeling. So, that is running on the narrow gauge. Is that clear? Okay. Now, let us come to the advantages of the railways. Now, the advantages of the railways, there are many advantages of the railways. If the railways are not running, then the times are very hard. So, the railways are of immense importance. So, let us study about the advantages of railways. And number one, railways help in the easy movement of bulky good and perishable commodities to distant places. Okay, so it is helping in the easy movement of the bulky goods. Then next important, that the railways transport raw material to the production center and finished goods to the market. So it is doing this job also, where it is taking the raw materials to the production units and it is carrying the finished goods to the market. Third one, railways have brought the villages closer to the cities and have helped to transfer new ideas and innovations to the rural areas. So when we say that the railways have brought villages closer to the cities, we mean not that it is coming nearer to the city, but it is bringing the people from the villages to the cities and from the cities to the villages in for transfer of new ideas and innovations. Next, railways help in reducing sufferings during the national calamities. That is also correct. Like they help a lot during the time of national calamity. They help to take relief items to these regions. Next, railways act as an integrating force, knitting the whole country into one whole with its huge network running throughout the country. Fine. Next, railways facilitate the easy movement of police, troops, and defense equipment. We come to the next page. Here, children. Railways provide comfortable journey as the trains have enough space to stretch legs, move in the corridors. At night, one can sleep comfortably on the berths provided in the train. So, railway is a very comfortable journey. Well, journey by railway is very comfortable in comparison to the others where you cannot move, you cannot stretch. But railways is very comfortable. Then railway travel is safer and comfortable for the families and babies and elders. Okay, because it's spacious and we can easily move, easily travel safe and in a comfortable way. Now just add another thing to this importance, advantages of railways, that it plays an important role in the process of economic development and urbanization. And it is a major employment sector as lakhs of people are dependent on railways for their livelihood. Please add this also. Now, it is said that it's not only the railways which is employing the people, the others also who are indirectly dependent on the railways for their livelihoods also gets affected. They are dependent on the railways for their livelihood. So during this time when there is a lockout, they are also getting affected when they are not able to carry out their own livelihood. Okay. Next we come to the disadvantages of railways. Okay, children, note that the railway lacks flexibility of routes. Train tracks cannot be laid everywhere region of the country, like the hilly region areas or the remote forest areas. So this is no doubt a very important drawback of the railways, because it cannot be laid everywhere. It cannot be in the hilly regions, except for very unique, very small areas. You will not find railways in the hilly regions. Neither will you find them in the remote forest areas. So, it cannot be laid everywhere. Next is, train travel can be very long and tedious, especially when compared to air travel. This is another disadvantage which everyone, and for that reasons now people days they are preferring the airways to reach their destination fast. So, train travel is very long, tedious in comparison to air travel. Then train tracks cannot be laid in the industrial region, and trains have to travel to a station where the cargo is loaded from a transportation to another. Most industrial locations have roads leading to them, but not all of them have train tracks leading to them. So all the industrial region do not have train tracks, and for that reason they have to be all the cargo have to be taken to the station, and from there it is to be loaded and it goes to the market. So it cannot reach directly from the industrial region. That is a drawback. It does not give door-to-door services like the roadways. Next is, the trains which run on coal produce a lot of air and noise pollution. That is also right. Next is, apart from that, trains cannot cross the oceans. They are limited to land travel only, and cannot normally haul products from one continent to the other. That is also right. Now, apart from that, railways, you can just add this, that railways face a tough competition with road transport, as roads can deliver the goods at the doorsteps. Then railways are unsafe due to poor maintenance and poor management, poor catering, poor maintenance of the train compartments. All this has given a very bad image to the railways in the eyes of the public. Okay, so that was the railways. Next we come to the airways. Air transport. Now, air transport started with a 10-kilometer airmail operation between Allahabad and Naini in 1911. However, the air transport made its progress only after India attained independence. At present, India has both domestic and international airlines. They can carry passenger, freight, and mail. The Airports Authority of India came into existence in April 1, 1995. So please underline that the Airports Authority of India came into existence on April 1, 1995 with the merger of the then two authorities, the National Airports Authority and the International Airports Authority. It is a nodal agency responsible for providing safe, efficient air traffic services and aeronautical communication services in the country. This authority manages 125 airports, including 81 domestic, 11 international, 8 customs, and 27 civil enclaves at defense airfields. So you may not underline all that, it's not important. Straight away we come to this side, the next paragraph, and we come to that the air transport in India is managed by two corporations. You may underline this, the Air India and the Indian Airlines. However, the two entities, that is the Air India and the Indian Airlines, were merged in 2007, and it is called Air India. Apart from Air India, there also has a number of private scheduled operators. Now this is the old record. Many of them have merged and they have been bought by some other company. You may underline still that the Jetline Airways, SpiceJet, Kingfisher, Go Airlines, there are others also, the Blue Aviation Private Limited, the Deccan Cargo, Express Logistics Private, you may underline these. Now coming to the Pawan Hans, now this is a very important Pawan Hans. It is the Pawan Hans Helicopter Limited, PHHL, please underline this. This was established in the year 1985 with the primary objective of providing helicopter support services to the oil sector in the offshore exploration, operate in the hilly and in the inaccessible areas to make available charter flights for the promotion of tourism. Now please, children, note that the dates are not important. No dates will be asked as to when it was established. But you must know the main objective of this Pawan Hans Helicopters Private Limited. Now, this is the primary objective was to provide, please, I'm sure you've underlined that when they were exploring oil from the offshore sectors. So, these Pawan Hans Helicopter Limited was of great help. They also operate in the hilly regions where the trains are not running, roads are not made. So in those inaccessible regions, these are very helpful. They are also helpful in the promotion of tourism. Okay, now next we come to the advantages of airways, which is very important. Children, please underline, it is the fastest and the comfortable mode of transport. It connects the far-flung remote areas of the country. Now, the speed and the ease with which the aeroplanes can cross mountain barriers, sandy deserts, large expanses of water, or the forest make the air transport indispensable. Just we cannot do without air transport because it can move with speed over all these inaccessible areas. Then, air transport is of particular importance during the natural calamities. It is used to airlift people from the affected areas, drop food, medicine, and other necessary things in the calamity affected areas. So, these are the advantages of air transport. Apart from this, the disadvantages of air transport, it is very costly. You may underline, it depends on weather conditions. You may underline. Then we turn to the next page and please focus here. Air transport is run on petroleum, which is non-renewable sources of energy. And air transport can carry small tonnage, but it has high freight charges. This is also, it is only able to carry a small amount of cargo, but it has high freight charges, which is also a big disadvantage of the air transport. To this, we come to the end of the session, but before we end, let me give you some assignment. And till question number 14, that is, give one advantage and disadvantage of air transport. Till this question, you need to do them in your registers. So, okay, children, stay safe, stay at home. Goodbye.